chairman is absent this evening. Commissioner Heller had something else to attend to. So we will run without her. Do we have any public comments? No public comments. Did everyone receive the minutes of the regular meeting for February 11th? Do I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
Is there any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? I will abstain. I was not at the meeting, so I'm not going to vote for the approval of the minutes. Okay, chair's report. Well, where is the chair's report? The chair didn't give me a report.
We turned on very loud just for the purpose.
She didn't give me a report. I believe there is nothing for the chair. You all have a copy of the financials that were passed out to you. That was up to today. There is no capital in non-recurring in there because it was not correct. So I did not copy it to pass it around for everyone to get all excited again, as we did last month. I will try to speak to Tony to see if we can't get it corrected and get a correct version. Chief, do you have anything you want to go over with our funds, or anybody has any questions on what's been used and what hasn't been used?
I have a question on the, I think you probably have the same question every month. I have a question on the hydrants. There's a 50% of the budget still left. Is that just a question of the billing cycles? There were 3/4 way through the year, but we still got 50% of the hydrant budget left.
We get 2 bills a year.
That's a big number, so.
The second bill usually comes at the end of June.
Okay, that's what I thought.
Comes, first of July.
Andy, why is the cleaning and custodial up so high? Isn't that something we should read the budget pretty closely, or what ran it up there?
No, that's, you see it's encumbered. The way you're reading it, we just pull a blanket purchase order for the whole entire year, and then we pull it out of that, because that number stays fixed month to month.
So in other words, it is pretty close.
Yeah.
The annual, we would expect the annual cost to be within $200 of the budget amount.
Yeah.
That's a fixed number. So instead of paying the bill, which is over the $200 purchase, we pull one purchase order for the year, and then we pay it on a monthly basis. So we divide that number by 12.
So that amount encumbered is going to go down every month.
The number encumbered goes down every month.
And the 97% will stay about the same then. Is that right?
The 97% is right. That's 97.5 is $7,800. Because once you encumber it, it shows it that it's used.
Like it's spent.
Like it's spent, because it's allotted to a specific line.
We expect our equipment rentals to go up any farther than they are at the moment?
No.
At 110%?
That number is incorrect. And I do not know if we've solved the issues, but from what I understand, once you pull the purchase order in Munis, and we had that issue in technical also, once we had a purchase order pulled, if I did not approve it, or you did not approve it in Munis, and we rejected it, the money was pulled out of the technical line on him. It would never go back there, and I'm not sure if they fixed the software to reallot it, but we cannot pull over the amount. That was something we ran into about 2 weeks ago.
Have we rejected purchase orders that were there?
Yes.
We have. Oh, you have, because I haven't. Okay. Anybody else have anything to say about the budget?
We pulled them on the wrong line item.
Okay.
Little things here and there, but if we didn't know that it was getting stuck in this limbo, it's not in the account, but it's not out of the account, you just can't reuse that money again, even though it didn't get spent. So, gasoline, we're in good shape. Electricity for the buildings, we have $5,000 left, so we should be fine. Heating oil, it appears we have $3,000 left. We're in good shape considering we're ending the heating season. As we said last month, hydrants are already over, which means that'd be over at the end of the year, but you know, that's a number we're going to deal with as we get to there.
Did you have something about gear replacement, the is going to affect this budget? Or is that something I'm talking about?
We're working on something, I'll bring it back on there.
Okay.
Yeah, I talked to Tony about that today.
Okay.
And you said hydrants are going to be over?
Yeah. It's over 50% now, and we paid 50% of the bill, so if we're at 52% now.
Well.
51.7 use.
If the rate is, if the second bill is the same as the first bill, then we're going to be $1,600 over on a $4,600 budget, $46,000 budget. Is that what you're talking, you're not talking about?
That's as long as nobody drives into a fire hydrant between now and then as well.
Well, it's.
Oh, we don't find anything, we're hit by snowballs, we go out and do the spring test.
When we do the spring testing of hydrants, sometimes a fire hydrant has been struck by a snowplow and somebody stood it back up, so no one would notice unless you went and put a hydrant wrench on it, and then it falls back over, at which point we then have to go and have that hydrant repaired.
That really happens.
Yes.
That happens about once or twice a year.
Those are true life situations.
Takes a pretty rugged snowplow to do it.
No, they're made to stand.
Not an 18-wheeler.
It'd be one of these orange vans, you're telling me.
No, if you hit one with the regular snowplow on, like an F-350, you'll snap that barrel.
Is it affected at all by any more lines that are put in by the water company?
Yes.
So
we haven't added any more.
But we haven't added any in the last year.
Okay.
We try to compensate. We compensated this year's budget for Lois and Marion.
Okay.
And we're going to have to compensate when we do Woodbridge Village and things of that nature. Other than that,
any other questions? Okay, we have a discussion on the recommended uses for the former firehouse, which I understand is going to be tabled right now. There's still too much discussion on it. You did receive some information in your packets. It's for information only at this moment. Read it and we will discuss it. Dr. Sapshin will tell us when it's about the right time to start discussing it. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we're just reading it and that's it. Secretary's report, do we have anything, Commissioner Burt?
Not on the restoration. There's still the insurance company in the town, I understand, are quite a bit apart, so they're negotiating. I know I've reported this at previous meetings, Andy, but the 24th of the month, the new door is going to be installed, I'm told. But I've been told each month that it's next week.
Yep.
So now I have a definite date that it's going to be the 24th. The siren is still, I have made no progress on that.
That's a week from today, the 24th.
That's correct. Siren on the old firehouse, I still haven't made any progress on that. I could use some help still, Andy, with the information.
We actually have that.
I'd like to get that back.
We have a call from the electrician.
Before we leave here tonight.
All right. And I will pursue it then vigorously once I have that in my hand.
Okay.
Okay. Fire Marshal's report. Fire Marshal Kavanaugh.
In the past month, we submitted a report to the town's insurance carrier regarding good improvements for reconstruction of the existing firehouse. At the request of Tony Genovese and Terry Gilbertson.
Did I get a report?
I didn't copy the fire commission on that report. It's a brief report just citing
the same,
it's all the same code issues we went over from 2003 up through and including the fire and thereafter.
Give me that.
Oh, I'm sorry, you need a copy of my report?
Yeah, well, anything.
Here, take it.
Yeah, you know.
I think there's some over there, isn't there?
There's one right in front of
you. He just left from here.
Okay. No, I pushed those over to you.
Okay, sorry. Pass.
Okay.
Yes.
I participated in Read Across America at Beach Road School at the request of the superintendents of schools. Reviewed possible changes in material for new firehouse for compliance with Connecticut State Fire Safety Code. The prefabricated building supplier wishes to changes submittal in regards to the insulation. And there was a question as to flame spread and smoke spread in case it ever caught fire. So I guess they now have to, with my approval, I don't know whether it's going to meet the specifications cited by Firehouse Building Committee. That's a totally separate issue. So that's something that the Building Committee is going to have to fight out with the supplier. Conducted a certificate of occupancy inspection for a new office complex on Litchfield Turnpike for an office for some new accountants down there. Conducted discussions with Amity High School administration about the establishment of a senior lounge area in unused hallway space. Held discussions with several residents about the need to employ licensed contractors to remove oil tanks. In the last couple of weeks, I've been fielding a lot of different phone calls with people that are trying to sell their houses and are surprised that the new banks won't write a mortgage on a house with an underground oil tank. And is there any cheap way that you can remove your own oil tank? And it's been interesting, but I informed them of the rules and regulations and recommended that they actually employ licensed and bonded contractor to do that work.
But at least they're asking you, they're not just going ahead and doing
that's
it.
That's true. Again, review of the emergency operations plan at Coachman Square. They're under new management again, or well, they're actually under the same owner, but a new management crew, I guess, has come in. And their emergency operation plan really hasn't been updated since they've been bought by Benchmark. So we're going to be going through that over the next couple of weeks. There's also going to be some training involved of their aides and review. There's a small complication with some of their residents have private aides that are not directly employed by Benchmark. They're employed by the residents or the resident's family to care for the individual. And there's, you know, there's no real way to work them into, well, do we count those people if we ever have to evacuate the building as assisting, or what do we do with those people, and how do we keep track of them in case that we actually have to evacuate that facility, or even evacuate parts of that facility during the firefighting episode. So we're trying to address a couple of big issues like that. Began system inspection on the library and concluded the inspection of the center building. Continued to work with the town to help meet their statutory responsibilities. Then I've also attached the report of Deputy Fire Marshal Scully's inspections for January, February, and March. He has been working on upgrading or assisting the chief and the captain to upgrade the firehouse software and get it to be a more useful tool for the fire marshal's office. So this is one of the reports he was able to generate with the new information we've begun to use in there.
That's very good.
It's a pretty report. Once we actually get to populate the entire database, mm-hmm. I think it'll be a good tool for us.
Is Amy helping with that?
Yes.
Okay.
Michael?
Yes.
The Assistant Fire Marshal Scully's report.
You'll see that a couple of the facilities are mentioned once or twice. That would be an initial inspection and then a re-inspection at a later date to ensure compliance or that changes have been made, sir.
I was also curious about the numbers in the front, the 200 and the 290. Are those different categories?
That is the 200 is the code for an inspection, and then if you'll notice the straight 200s are a general inspection and the 290s are inspection others, which are generally the follow-ups. I think there's like general inspection complaint, inspection post-fire, so those are just the codes that the firehouse software gives it.
Well, it gives you some idea of how much time is spent on them, which is I think, what everyone was looking for, if I'm not mistaken. Very good, thank you. Does anybody else have any questions about the fire marshal's report? Okay. Fire chief. Well, there's also an update on the fire marshal's replacement vehicle. I'm sorry, I see that on the agenda. Do we have an update on that? Okay, what's going on here? Cut that out.
Okay. The fire marshal's vehicle has been delivered. We are still working with the state contractor to finish his work.
Okay, that doesn't sound good.
Well, they shipped the vehicle without installing all of the extras that we have, well, that we had contracted to have them install. And we're waiting for a date for them to come up and finish installing.
Is the aftermarket, some of the aftermarket goods?
Yes, it's mainly the four lights in the front grill. They need to reinstall an antenna mount. I'm trying to remember the whole list. I think those are the major things, and then they actually have to insert some diodes into the controller, that the light controller that they've supplied, or they supplied the controller but they didn't supply the diodes because they didn't have all the lights installed to make them work in the proper order. So, you know, it's probably 4 or 6 hours of work that needs to be done on the truck.
Does any of this interfere with the safe operation of the vehicle right now?
No, the vehicle can operate safely. Does it do everything we want it to do? No.
Okay.
I mean, we have lights that work, but in an ideal world, you have three settings of lights, so you can turn on certain lights. Now you throw the switch, every light on the truck comes on, and it's an all or nothing.
Okay, so but you can operate adequately,
yes,
temporarily.
I can operate in a safe manner.
Okay.
Was this the dealer that you're waiting for?
Yes.
You got to take it to him, or
they're supposed to be sending the man here. They sent him here once, but they didn't send him with all the parts. So he corrected about a third of what was wrong initially, and now we're waiting for them to come back.
And this
back.
Is, what is this, Warnock?
Warnock.
And they're out of New Jersey?
They're out of New Jersey.
Okay.
But they keep, on a semi-regular basis, they're sending a technician up to Connecticut because they also have a contract with the state police, and a number of their vehicles have come through with similar deficiencies. Okay. So when the technician comes up to fix those, we're trying to get him to schedule to stop by here to fix ours.
Yeah, and this was when we purchased this through the state bid process, so that it was the lowest price we could get, and that's why we went with this particular dealer, because he was one of those qualified, he had won the state bid.
And he discounted the lights for us because it was part of the state bid. Unfortunately, you get what you pay for.
And has payment been fully made on this?
Actually, the finance department is holding payment on.
Okay, well, it's a little incentive.
No. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Fire chief.
Thank you. This month we've been working on Woodbridge Village is back. I know the fire marshal's smile comes over his face. Woodbridge Village is the over 55 community they're proposing for Bradley Road. They came to us once before last year, and after we spent
about 3 weeks.
Yeah, we spent weeks and about 8 evenings and the traffic consultant to find out that they were missing their setback by 25 or 50 feet, which I strongly opposed that the planning and zoning people could have figured that out ahead of time before we wasted our time. But we are actively reviewing their plans and the traffic patterns again. We're gonna go over it again tomorrow, and we have to get back to them by the 4th?
The 7th is the next planning and zoning meeting. They wish us to attend that. They would like us to meet with the traffic consultant and Supposedly, the representatives of Woodbridge Village have been strongly trying to contact us by the words in the emails that we've gotten from planning and zoning. However, myself nor the chief have received a voicemail, and
no,
Amy hasn't received any phone calls, so I don't know what number they're using to try and contact us, but it's not working.
Perhaps we can provide...
They had a 10 o'clock meeting the other morning with the police department about the traffic issue, but as we instructed, 10 o'clock meetings are not convenient.
Correct.
So I'm sure they're going to come back to us and we're going to go over this. We can spend all night on it, but...
We had one road.
You know, there's hundreds of feet of driveway that we're going to have to review and find some turnarounds and things.
Just to be able to get the emergency, the trucks and in and out.
Yes,
right. Now, can you just explain the different roles that the that you have or the chief has in the department versus the fire marshal in reviewing this application? You're both involved.
Yes.
How come?
We're involved for termination.
And we actually work together. Imagine that.
No, I know. It's the same department. I got that.
He's more on the life safety, and I've got to make sure that we can maneuver vehicles to get in there and put a fire out safely and have access to all sides of the building, watch out for the obstacles of dumpsters and vehicles, and the fire marshal make sure that we have fire lanes and proper...
Is that a code issue? That's not a code issue, so technically.
I don't think that's a code issue.
Theoretically, establishing the fire lanes falls under my jurisdiction. Now, while I am familiar with the fire trucks, not as familiar with the actual turning radiuses and capabilities as the chiefs are, because guess what? They're their trucks.
They drive them.
So we work together to make sure their trucks fit in, and I make sure they have all the room they need.
We go over the placement of the hydrants.
Yeah.
We don't want a hydrant too far away. We don't want a hydrant buried, although some developers find that hydrants are big and ugly and we'll bury them in the corner. When it comes to use it, they've also designated the area as the hydrant, maybe the, what they call that, the snow area?
Snow shed area.
The snow shed area, that's where they pile all the snow in the wintertime. So, and you have to, you go to these meetings and you nicely look at the developer and say, it's a really great idea, but in all practicality, the snowplow guy is going to bury this hydrant if we ever need it. We'll never get it if we need it.
We'll need it in the summertime.
Right. You know, the theory last time with the building was that no one would ever go on the roof. That's very big thinking. They actually brought us in, I'm sorry, you weren't on the commission. They brought us in a consultant to try to fight fires. He was going to instruct myself and the fire marshal and the captain, the assistant chief, on how to fight a fire in their building. And after 10 minutes with him, he decided that our way of fighting fires was a lot better idea than what he had.
What have you done about the height? Getting out?
They've lowered the building.
They've lowered the building. As part of the new agreement with planning and zoning, they've changed the setback to what planning and zoning has asked for, and the maximum height of the building is now 45 feet. It was up in the 50s.
53, 56 feet before.
Okay. So
it's not only the height, it's your means
your
of access.
Reach. Yeah,
your
right
reach.
There.
You've got
over
vehicles
it.
Parking in front of those.
Yeah.
They were going to buy us ladders last time. Remember that 50-foot
yeah,
ladders?
Yeah.
And we were going to store them in the back of the building, and no one was going to test them. So, in some of it. Roof hatches. Remember the roof fence?
They're going to have roof automated roof vents so we didn't have to go
so
up
and
the roof in case of a fire.
Yeah, we're going to have to evaluate exactly. It's not, the building's only 50 feet, but you're going to have a good 20-foot reach from islands and dumpsters and other things in the way. So, yeah, we're going to evaluate all that. We've been reviewing the plans for the new building, the technology, the telephone, the computers. Spent the weekend going over those issues. Those are just about ready to go out to bid, from what I understand. So we will be submitting, hopefully, in the next week or two to the Board of Selectmen. Are they approve those, Jim?
Did they come up?
I know that, I think they went, you approved them. I don't think we officially went out to bid yet on them, but.
I think we approved.
We're just putting the final dot in the Ts and dot in the Is on the technology. There's an awful lot of cabling we're doing, but we are cabling the building for the 21st century here.
I think we approved them to go out to bid.
To go out to bid, right. So now we just, we put the legal wording in them, making sure that we didn't miss anything, and we'll get those out in the next week or two.
Which, by the way, I raised the issue, that really wasn't necessary. It was just done as part of the process. I mean, okay. It wasn't necessary that the Board of Selectmen approve it before it got to the bid, but anyway.
What about the office trailer, electrical? Anything going on with that? What are you laughing for?
It's interesting, you know, we don't have an electrical problem, and we can be here all the time, but the light that they installed at the flagpole, I came in the other day, and if we don't have surges in the building, I'm not sure why we have a surge protector for the light on the flagpole. We now have a dedicated surge protector for the flagpole light, because I believe it blew out 3-4 times. So I think everybody's come to the conclusion we have a problem, but we're just not going to address it until it's like the door. We're just going to let it go until we rewire the building.
I understand we have not had a failure in the last couple of months. Is that right? Or is that?
About a month and a half.
Is that right? I was told a couple of months, but that's
not that we know. Not that we've been informed.
Well, you would have known the generator would have kicked on, right?
But the people come in the morning and shut it off, so if nobody caught it on, it may not have been something we picked up on.
I don't know, I that's what I had heard anyway.
So if the generator kicks on, if the thing the circuit breaker trips and the generator kicks on overnight, the only maintenance come in the morning and reset it,
yep.
And no one in the department necessarily have any idea.
Right, correct.
Who would be doing that?
Building maintenance.
Building.
Is it alarmed? Is there a notification? Do they find out? They must know. Or they just hear it when they drive by?
Yeah. No, there's no alarm on anymore. There's no more boiler flame out alarm. All the stuff was going after the fire. None of those circuitry was hooked back up. And on a positive note, we have, which Commissioner Latham had brought up earlier, with the help of Captain Perrietti here, we have approximately in the last 4 months, 7 new applicants for membership.
All right.
So we are doing excellent in this manner. The issue has arisen, how do we never planned on this. How do we purchase gear, two-way radios for these prospective members to keep them safe? So what we are developing right now is we don't have it in the budget. You can look in the budget. We can find a few dollars here and there. We're looking for $20,000 to $25,000. I have 4 people right now in Firefighter 1. I have 3 prospective members right now going to the June school. So that gives us a couple of months to get them in and get some gear. And through you know, old gear, we're going to try to work some stuff together, but we're going to have to purchase some new equipment. So what we're going to do is find a way to come up with $20,000 to $25,000 to properly equip these people.
Is there a limit on the size of the force? Have you reached that limit?
65. 50 active and 15 probation. That does not include my senior and honorary members.
I mean, I'm thinking of volunteer department, pretty much the more volunteers you have, the better.
It is an excellent problem to have.
Yeah, and it's not like another town department that's paid and you have a budget and you know have so many
right.
People and schedule, whereas a volunteer force is more important, more to have more. Which
in my 26 years of being here, I cannot tell you the last time we took in 7 people in 1 year, let alone 7 people in under 6 months.
So, do you have a figure
92.
per one, you know, per new fella, what it costs to equip them?
A turnout coat would be $975. Turnout pants are $675. Total gear, yeah, about $4,100 per person.
Per person.
Per person. From a radio to gloves. to an SCBA mask, to boots.
What about our junior members?
One of the junior members is the people that are coming up.
Now, no, fine.
Fabulous.
Yes.
That's great.
So one of our junior members is coming on.
So we're starting to see positive developments from everything we've been doing the past,
yes,
past few years, in terms of the new firehouse, the junior corps.
Anything else, Chief?
I'm all set. That's it.
What about the, do we have any discussion on the possible truck committees? Are we going to set a committee?
We are going to set up, I am going to set up a committee. I'm going to look and see if any of my commissioners want to volunteer. I'm going to need a truck committee for a ladder truck committee, mm-hmm, and a tanker truck committee.
Those would be separate committees?
Separate committees. Tanker truck should be a pretty cut and dry deal, where the ladder truck is going to take extensive amount of work and time. Of course, it goes with the cost of the two different vehicles, one at $200,000 and one at $1 million, so.
Okay.
But we have those two committees, and I'll speak with the commissioners afterwards and see if anybody's interested.
Anybody has any interest in it, please see the chief so we can get something going.
You must be available and have time.
I wouldn't be much help. I don't know anything about them.
I'm all set.
Okay.
I want to, before the chief gets through, I want to thank him for Chief Dunn, what you did for him.
Yep.
They went to the wake, they went to the burial ground, and they went to the church.
Yep.
And I think it was a nice job you did for him.
Thank you. We had a good turnout in at Hampton that night, and I know we had...
At 9...
We had another commitment that afternoon too.
Yes.
We had two commitments on Saturday, as well as the,
yes,
funeral and the church service.
Yes.
And the funeral was in the morning, and the service was in the afternoon, which threw people for a loop. Normally they
reversed.
They reversed. So, but we did the best we can, and I know we got
job.
A lot of thank you letters and everything. So thank you.
Okay, Assistant Chief Berlin, activity report.
The activity report, what you have in front of you is basically what we went over last month. Just we added more calls to the computer, so we are moving forward with that. Keep a look at the sheet. You can go through it if you want. Look at it if you have any questions. Feel free. It's basically the same as last time. It's just we entered more calls than the computer this past month. Call volume from last year at this time to this year at this time is the exact same. So the walk go down exactly the same to date right now.
I wasn't here last month. You tell me the first page or second page total number of incidents was 75 during this time period?
Right.
11208. And the responding personnel, is that in?
That's total amount of people. That's how you get your average turnout. So you take the 652 divided by 75, you should average of 9 people per call.
Okay.
And has the turnout been, how was that turnout? So good turnouts on hand? I imagine the turnout varies depending on the nature.
If you look at last month's report, we had 8. Average turnout last month was 8. We have last month's paperwork in front of us here. Because we saved our paperwork from last month, not to kill a tree.
How are we doing on drivers? Do we have enough drivers? Or
we have
to train
a new
drivers?
Driving program going into effect. We have a new instructor on board that we pulled the purchase order for 2 weeks ago. Remember you signed off on that? So we have 5 people that are going to be working extensively on vehicle operations and pumping and driving. And when we finish with 5, we will be taking the next 5 on. One-on-one, individual, hands-on.
Is it your desire to have all firemen knowledgeable in the driving and pumping, or are you...
Knowledgeable, yes. I'd like to get some of the more senior, non-interior firefighters refreshed and up to speed on the vehicles, and also prepare them for the new rescue coming in. So we're going to take some of the older drivers we have that don't drive all the vehicles, train them, retrain them, and refresh them on the vehicle they do drive, and then move them forward on the vehicles that they have not driven.
Okay.
Who's the instructor?
I've got a gentleman from the Valley, the fire school. He's a career firefighter, certified pump instructor, driving instructor, CAPS instructor.
He's also a volunteer in Oxford.
He's a volunteer in Oxford, too.
So
we have a very well-rounded person.
Now, after they've been trained, will there be a CDL come with it for them?
Everyone, they won't be doing the training if they don't have the CDL.
They got to have CDL to start.
Yep. CDL or a Q. The state still takes the class two and the Q endorsements on your license for fire apparatus.
Is that still effective?
Yes, yes.
For how long?
We haven't been informed of any deadline on it.
Okay.
Although the majority of our members have CDL class Bs.
Okay.
I think we only have two, three Q endorsements. Then when we get enough people up together, there was a class, Allingtown was running a Q class, that's next month if I need them. Mm-hmm. So we can always get them a Q, or we can send them a CDL school. But at this time, I don't need any more people with CDLs. I need to get the people we have up to speed.
Sounds okay.
How about the rescue vehicle? Do we have an update on the delivery of that?
The assistant chief will be talking to you about that tonight.
The
vehicle, and I don't remember where we were last month on this, the vehicle's finished. For all intents and purposes, that vehicle is finished down there.
Mm-hmm.
The vehicle's finished, awaiting for our truck committee to inspect it.
We have to inspect it there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And what's going to promote that?
I didn't really.
We were gonna talk about this afterwards. We're gonna make a trip down to Florida, take a look at the truck. Once we inspect the truck, then the truck gets shipped up here, has some work done, and it goes to Pennsylvania for the AMCUS system they put on it, and then we get the truck back, we put it in service. So we're probably looking mid-June, to have the truck fully in service with the AMCUS and everything else on it.
And who will go to Florida to look at the truck?
It's up to the truck committee. So we'll have a meeting very shortly and discuss who's going to go.
Okay.
We got a little thrown off with the... It came in a little earlier than we wanted to.
Than you were expecting.
We didn't expect it to
May, June, for it to go down and inspect it.
Okay.
And they called us the end of February, beginning of March. You know, what we've done is... we've gone over line by line, make sure that the vehicle should be ready by the time we get there. Everything that's supposed to be on is on it. So they go down there, they can test run it, kick the tires, slam the doors, put it through its operations and make sure everything's acceptable. And what they'll do is they'll pack it up and ship it up to Wellington.
You have a line sheet on it now? Complete line sheet?
We do. We don't have one with us right tonight. We haven't, though.
I'd like to get one.
Okay.
When it comes in, get a complete line sheet. So when it comes in, sort of go over myself a little bit. I know a little bit about it.
Not a problem. We want to make sure, you know, the generator, when we took the generator off, the amp is off. You want to make sure the reels were gone, the compartment, and tie up little loose ends. What was it, the decals?
Yeah.
You know, there's decals with the writing where the gold leaf goes on the doors. We keep every vehicle very similar to the previous vehicle. Unfortunately, on this one here, there's a light in the middle of the decal. I've got about 10 pictures on my desk of the vehicle, and what we've been doing is going back and forth to how we have our vehicles now and how they can put the gold leaf on this one and make them all look the same.
Is it about the signage? The signs
yes.
on the vehicle?
Correct. They don't call them signs.
The lettering.
Lettering. The
yes.
Lettering.
Okay. Signs.
Material.
Commercial
material. It's not. We're not getting like a gold-plated truck here. So, despite the cost, I mean, this is it's lettering that's important for identification purposes and for safety purposes. I mean, it's not there for. It's not decoration.
It's actually the town of Woodbridge that's on the door, right? It's the town of Woodbridge
yes.
that's in the light. And normally you wouldn't want to break that up with something in the middle of it. So.
We need so much striping on the truck for safety purposes. I just see reflective striping, so that striping we can't really play with that much. So we have to move some other lettering around to accommodate that.
Those are easy problems. They just take time.
Anything else?
I'm all set.
Thank you. Commissioner Alexiades. New fire station building committee report.
Well, I'm happy to report that the building is well underway. The foundation was being poured. I'm not sure that the pouring is pouring done yet.
They got the four walls. I think they are pouring the floor this week. Was the last I heard.
We received the guaranteed maximum price from the contractor. It was approved by the Board of Selectmen. And everything so far is within the guaranteed price and within budget. The building committee will be organizing a site walk for the building committee members sometime in the next few weeks, preferably when it's not raining and sloppy and muddy mm-hmm. out there. And if any commissioners are interested in participating on that walkthrough, looking at doing it on a Saturday morning probably, we'll let me know and we'll get word out to you.
Okay, great. I'd like to see that actually.
Now, how bad was the man hurt that was hurt over there?
I have no man was hurt.
I heard a broken leg.
Broken leg? Exactly. There's something serious, I heard.
Last Tuesday, one of the site guys got hit by a bucket on the machine, or was adjusting a bucket, and the bucket fell off or something. I haven't seen an official report yet.
No, that would have been after the last building committee meeting.
There's nothing really, just a broken leg.
No,
okay.
Just to the membership.
The last I heard. Just
haven't
heard an
That's
update
all.
This week.
There's nothing just about it.
So. I know there was an OSHA inspection afterwards.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, it looks exciting. There's certainly enough equipment over there.
So far, so good.
Look like they get in each other's way, but I guess they've got it figured out.
What are we going to do with all the rock?
We're crushing.
The rock is being
sold to somebody.
No, it's being crushed and used and reused on site as gravel.
They get a crusher to bring.
They bring a crusher in because you know rock over a certain size, as you, I'm sure you know,
yeah.
can't be buried because then you have
That's
issues
right.
about settling and it's
right.
not a stable environment underground. So each rock has been measured and cataloged and it will be crushed on site for reuse. As part of the material on site.
Excellent.
Instead of otherwise, you're paying to haul it off and dispose of it because you can't use it.
Excellent.
So that's the plan. And that's also considered a green construction practice, an environmentally responsible construction practice to reuse the materials on site rather than shipping them off and dumping them somewhere else.
And that was mostly that one, just one big rock?
Well, there's a big pile out there.
There's a pile, but
I
thought there was one big, huge one to start with.
There's a bunch of large ones out there. They actually measured them all, and we went through that in a meeting. I was amazed because I didn't know they actually catalog and take pictures and measure them to see how large they are and what they can do with them. Because if there was too many rocks, welcome to Woodbridge. We have to pay extra.
Well, yeah, because there's so many provided, you know,
and you had to.
In front of the contract. No, I think
we have a little overage in there. Yeah,
we have
something small on there. But yeah, there was a lot of rock. But they're going to crush it and put it down as base.
Great. So if they take, I mean, I don't know where the size cutoff is or not, but they've got I mean, they take a little digital picture of each, they spray paint a number on each one, they take a digital picture. I mean, it's much more involved than I would have expected, not knowing about the process ahead of time.
Very involved in cataloging rocks.
Well, it's money for them. They're going to save money somewheres by be able to crush this rock up and reusing it than going out and buying it. That's my thoughts.
But then they have to crush it.
Well, yeah. So I mean, there's an expense associated with crushing it, but it beats hauling the rock off and disposing of it, and then making another trip to bring in loads of gravel. Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you,
Alex. I'd like to take a walk when they're going to do it.
Give me a call. Okay. I don't know when it's going to be yet, but we're talking. You know, hopefully sometime in the next couple of weeks. As long as when it's safe to walk around there.
Okay.
Do we have an apparatus report? No one here for that. Can you tell us anything going on? Is there any bad news or good news?
No. You know what? We have absolutely no bad news. We fixed the electrical problems in engine 2. We fixed the hydraulic problems in the ladder truck. I'm looking across the room because as I look across the room, at least it makes me think here as we're doing this. But. No, we have no other large expenditures that come to mind at this time. We're getting ready to do the spring pump testing and the lube oil and filters.
We already pulled purchase orders on
those? Those are the blankets, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. We have a leak in the tanker, which is going to go out and get serviced. Not a big deal. We just got to drain the water so we can weld the aluminum.
Okay.
Little spot hole there, Bob.
You got a certified welder?
Yes. Yeah. Oh, we're not doing it ourselves.
No, I just wondered who would be the certified welder or not.
Oh, we'll send it to one of the tanker places to do that.
Okay.
Either we'll send it to Petrotech, or we'll send it out to Twin Lights, or we'll send it up to Gowans.
Okay.
Where they have...
two of them I know they're good that you just mentioned.
Gowan,
yeah.
That's the old tanker that will be replaced.
You saw it that night.
Down the road?
Yeah. You saw that.
That's the tanker you said that was in good shape, though. The last meeting I went to.
It's a little drip. I don't know how to explain it.
It's a pinhole on a seam.
Will they inspect the inside of the tank once you get it out? Because most likely you got to go inside to weld it. It ought to be inspected, the inside, make sure there isn't acid or something from the water underneath.
We can put something in it. I, you know what, I leave them to the tanker professionals here as to what they want to do with it. I tell them I got a leak. I'm sure they're going to look at the inside and the outside to see where you're going to weld it. Obviously, with that polished aluminum finish, I'm not a welder. Stop.
Yeah.
I don't know anything about welding. Stop. So... in order to weld that, I don't want this big spot on the outside of it. They're going to have to, you know, do it the right way, whatever way that may be. But it is right in the weld of the seam, 3/4 of the way up the tank. But it's just a...
So it must be an inspection cover on the top of that.
Oh, yeah, you can jump right into it.
Yeah, but I just wondered, if we weld up one spot, maybe down the road another 3-4 months, another spot will come out. Somebody got to go inside and inspect it.
Pressure test the tank.
Well, that might hold up, but somebody go physical looking at it is sometimes the better way.
You can't physically look at it.
Why? If you've got a manhole inspection.
You've got a 16-inch manhole, and you have a dozen baffles. You can't crawl in between the baffles. So the way they do it is they pressure test the tank.
Okay.
I think this is the first problem we've had in 70... 80-something, this is 15, 20 years, the first problem we've had, so.
Do we have any other business that needs to be discussed this evening? We have to schedule a special meeting. We've had an item come up that the Commissioner Heller would like to be here for, so we would ask if anyone has some time. Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, one question.
Okay. Speak up.
Go ahead.
On your capital budget, I thought were some radios. Yes. I brought in my wrong book.
We watched, I watched the Board of Finance.
Aren't, didn't you say you really needed these radios?
I think that was.
Those were pagers.
Huh?
Those were the pagers that we talked about. $3,600 for pagers, right?
No, it was more than that. This was a bigger bill.
That might, are you sure? That wasn't for 2010?
No, this is this year. This is for the coming year.
There's a radio line item for the fire marshal's truck, but that's.
That was the cap, oh, you mean the capital non-recurring?
Yes.
Right. Yeah, that was the $46,000 that was cut out.
All right, so could you explain to me, because we have a meeting this week, could you explain to me really quickly? Because I could have sworn you said, the ones you have are shot. That's what I thought I heard.
Yep.
That's what I wrote down in my notes.
Yep.
So just.
Those are the ones that the previous budget year, member of the Board of Finance said that, you know, because the toaster is old, they don't replace their toaster.
Yeah.
Yes.
These
are the radios that are no longer, they are not narrow band required. This goes back to where we had the discussion about the narrow banding and the APCO 25. We have a lot of older mobile radios and portable radios that were purchased prior to the town's simulcast system. This was 5 to 10 years prior to we bought the simulcast system, at which time the fire department did not receive any mobile or portable radio equipment. We only got the tower sites connected to the rest of it. We need to replace those mobiles and portables that were original, which are now well over 10 years old.
So they can communicate with other.
There is a mandate that we go narrowband. We obviously can't, and we will not be able to renew our license until we do that. If we do that, all those radios will stop functioning. But also, they are giving us numerous problems with failures.
That's what I thought I heard.
Right.
So we do have failures. Right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what I thought I heard. That's what I thought. Okay.
So you've got units that are failing, so you need to replace them on an ongoing basis so that you have proper operating equipment. And it's also part of the overall plan to replace the equipment for the new standard.
That's right. They've been in there to replace them and upgrade them even before we had the standard and the narrow banding requirements. We've just extended that and pushed it out a few more years. So that
but
it was financially responsible, but now
the narrow banding requirement that you need.
The narrow banding is something that we absolutely need to do.
I know that.
Right.
But besides that, they're
besides not. Besides that, the radios are no longer reliability. It's reliability in the vehicle.
Replace them all at once.
Yeah.
Is it all or nothing?
Is it all or nothing?
I don't know.
We could piece it. We could piece it. I'd like to do them all. You know what?
Okay.
You get better pricing when you buy in lots of 5 or 8 than
right.
You do buying individual one-piece units.
Okay.
You do get better pricing on buying discounts.
Do you remember how much they were, Andrew? What are they? So
the fire marshal's radio was $1,800 for his car.
$1,870.
The radio that we are putting in the new rescue was $2,400. So. Yeah, but that's where you saw, yeah, we had $40,000, and when you multiply, that's only 20 radios.
20 radios, okay.
You know, it's only 20 radios in round numbers.
Okay.
We run a department of 54 members and 14 vehicles.
Gotcha.
Okay. Jen, I would suggest that this is really important. This is an important safety issue.
That's why I'm bringing
it up. Yeah, no, I know. That's
why I'm going to bring it up.
She wants the arguments. She needs her arguments set forth. So
I needed to understand,
whatever we
give more time, and so that Thursday night we can talk about it again.
Okay. Back to our special meeting. We need to set up a special meeting for next week. Everybody get out their calendars and tell us what we can do. We'll send you the agenda and the information. It has been suggested that the 26th on Wednesday would be a good night. I do not know even where we will meet at that point. We will have to notify you because I don't know what's available. except it was, maybe this room was available because you told me that the Board of Selectmen was supposed to meet and they are not. Is that correct?
Sorry, what day are you looking at?
We're looking at next Wednesday, the 26th of March. And it's a special meeting, it shouldn't take that long, but...
What time? 7:30?
Yeah. If everyone can make it.
I'm okay.
Is that a good... Liam?
I'm good.
Would it, at a different time?
It's a short meeting?
Yes.
Could we do it at 7?
Could we do it at 7? I could do it at 7, could you do it at 7? Jim? Chief?
I'll be here anyway.
Then we'll set it up for the 26th and Beth will get a agenda posted with the town clerk, Suzie. So she'll take care of that. So 7 p.m. and I'll notify you if it's any different, otherwise we'll plan on being here. Okay, we have nothing for executive session, I don't believe. Anybody have a motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second?
Sorry.
All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Opposed? Thank you all.
Let's have another cup of coffee, let's have another piece of pie. Trouble's just a bubble, and the clouds will soon roll by. So let's have another cup of coffee, and let's have another piece of pie. Let a smile be your umbrella, for it's just an April shower. Even John D. Rockefeller is looking for the silver lining. Mr. Herbert Hoover says that now's the time to buy. So let's have another cup of coffee, and let's have another piece of pie.